So thank you for the nice introduction, and also I would like to thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity to give this talk. And today I'm going to talk about the uncertainties in gas kinematics arising from stellar continuum modeling using intragalactic spectroscopy data. This work has been done in collaboration with the Autonoma University team. Well, in this work, we want to study how the derivation of the pure gas kinematics can be affected by the choice of different stellar subtraction methods and different light fitting approaches. As you can see in the figure on the left, when we observe a galaxy, we get information from the gas and the star emission. This emission is shown here in black. If you want to get the pure gas emission, you need to remove the star's contribution. So the stellar contribution is shown here in red, and once you remove this component, you finally get the pure gas emission, here shown in blue. In this work, we are mainly interested in the H-alpha nitrogen 2 complex, which trace the ionized component in the galaxy. And on the right, you can see an example of a typical line fitting approach you can apply to the H-alpha, which is the line in the middle, and the nitrogen 2 complex. This is a specific case of taken from the luminous and ultraluminous infrared sample studied a couple of years ago. And here in particular, we can identify a systemic component, which is a component we generally extend over the line emitting region in the galaxies, and also an outflow component, which is generally identified using broader blue shifted emission. According to the line, following the line profile approach, we are able to obtain information for each line. Has the flux intensity, the centroid of the line, and the width. With the use of intragraphy spectroscopy, we are able to get 3D information. In particular, spatial and spectral information can be obtained at the same time. When we observe a spectrum in a galaxy, in each spectrum we obtain information of the gas in the different phases. In particular, we can study the H-alpha emission, which allow us to study the warm ionized phase. We also have the opportunity to observe the nitrogen doublet absorption, which traces the natural gas. And we also can observe the underlying stellar population. Here is an example of the typical map we can get, for example, for the H-alpha wavelength. And these are the results of local luminous infrared galaxies, EC4689. And these maps can be obtained for each component we use in the galaxy. So why intragraphy spectroscopy is so important? The two-dimensional kinematic characterization of galaxies provide a powerful diagnostic tool which allow us to infer the main source of dynamical support. In particular, we can define the dynamical ratio, which is the ratio between the velocity and velocity dispersion. If this ratio is larger than one, we can say that the galaxy is supported by rotation. If lower than one, we can say that the galaxy is dispersion dominated. This tool allows us to detect and characterize a radial motion associated with feedback mechanisms like outflows, as an example I showed you before. We can also infer fundamental quantities like the dynamical mass. We also are able to constrain modes of subformation in galaxies with ambiguous morphologies. Indeed, we know that there are two main galaxy evolutionary scenarios. In the first one, we know that the major merger controls the evolution of the galaxy. And so we expect to find complex morphology and kinematics in the galaxy. This is the so-called merger galaxy sample. For what concerns the steady cool gas accretion, we expect that cold flows or manual mergers are able to support the gas directly into the center of the galaxy. And this has been done in a smooth way. So we expect to find a regular morphology and kinematics. And here are the so-called these galaxies. Here I show an example of the NGC 1614, which is a typical merger galaxies, and another galaxies, which is a local luminous infrared galaxies with a very regular morphology. But in some cases, we see regular morphology characterized by regular kinematics. I show here an example taken from the work by Poste-Schraber 2010 for a star-forming galaxy observed at redshift 2 with Symphony and adaptive optics. Here you can see on the left and in the middle panel that the H-alpha and the H-band images are characterized by irregular and clumpy structure, while the velocity field of this object is very regular. So the morphology is easy to obtain, but could be misleading in some cases. The target of our work is the NGC 2906, which is a nearby normal star-forming galaxy observed with NEWSA at very large telescope. This object has been included in the pilot study of the AMUSING sample from Galvani et al. 2016. And the AMUSING stands for All-Weather MUSE Supernova Integral Field of Nearby Galaxies, since it hosts the Type 2N Supernova 2005 EP. It's basically located in the northern part of the galaxy. I'll show you later an image. Then with MUSE, we are able to observe a field of view of 1 minus square with a spatial sampling of 0.2 arcsecond. And in this case, with this spatial sampling, we are able to sample like 30 parsec per spaxel. From this data cube, we obtain more than 10,000 spectra for this object, and we are receiving the wavelength coverage and the wavelength range in between 4,700 and 9,400 Armstrong, with a mean resolution of 3,000. The sync condition for this object of the order are similar to 0.9 arcsecond. So with MUSE, it is possible to combine wind sync condition with a large field of view and a spatial sampling sufficient to properly sample the point spread function. So it is a very well suited instrument to study the kinematics of our object in detail. The first step of our analysis is the selection of the spectra. In the figure below, you see the H-alpha flux emission map of our object. Here, the location of the supernovae 2005 EP. The white box highlighted the region we selected for our analysis, which is zoom in the right panel. So we selected 12 spectra. 5 of them have been located in the nuclear region, while the remaining 7 are located in the outer part. The minimum separation between these spectra is between 0.6 arcsecond, and we reach the maximum separation about 12 arcsecond. And this allows us to properly sample the PSF. These spectra are characterized by different nitrogen H-alpha ratio that I show you in the right part of this table. And in particular, in magenta, I highlight the central spectra shown here in the very inner region of the galaxy, which show the highest nitrogen to H-alpha ratio. Then I show you the spectra in order to visualize their shape. And all this range of nitrogen to H-alpha ratio will allow us to ensure that this spectra are representative of a wide range of physical condition and signal-to-noise ratio. So as I said, the nuclear region show the highest nitrogen H-alpha ratio, and the reason why is due to the strongly absorbed H-alpha emission in the inner region of the galaxy. These can be compared to the outer region in which we get the highest H-alpha emission. And so we get the lower nitrogen H-alpha ratio. After selecting this spectrum, we have to subtract the Stellan continuum emission, where you, as you know, there are lots of methods you can use to remove the Stellan continuum emission, but we mainly focus using three different methods. The first one is the FIT 3D method. The second one is the starlight method. and then the PPXF method. Here you can see the several references if you want to know more information. Each method has been combined with a specific library. So we combine the Fit3D method with the Granada and Miles library. The Starlight method has been combined with the Miles library and the Stellib libraries. And the PPXF method has been combined with a library, Miles library. Each combination is characterized by different isochron and EMF, different rain and metallicity. And in the last right part of the last column on the table, you see the resolution of the stellar library, which is in the range between 2 and 3 angstrom. After removing the stellar emission, we will focus on the different left-hitting approaches we can use. As I said before, we focus on the H-alpha nitrogen 2 complex, and using the line fitting MP fit expert from the ADN and Python code, we are able to derive the flux, the centroid, and the width of each line. As I said before, this galaxy is a Norman galaxy, so no outflow are present in this object. And we are able to fit each line using a single Gaussian profile. And this is an example, one of the spectra I study. The total emission is a combination of a continuum emission, which is a straight line with a certain slope, plus the 3 Gaussians. The flux ratio in between the nitrogen 2 line is kept fixed according to the atomic fixity, to be the ratio of in relation of 3:1. And then we can consider different cases in order to link or not the H alpha nitrogen emission. In particular, for the kinematics, you can fix the separation between the H-alpha and the nitrogen 2 lines, and also the width of the line. So according to these two cases, we can get 4 different combinations. In the first one, we can fix the wavelength separation between the lines and the width of the line. In the second case, we get fixed the velocity dispersion, the width of the line. In the third case, we fix the wavelength separation. And in the last case, we didn't put any constraint. Oops. Here I show you the result after removing the stellar continuum emission, after using the Fit3D method, which is shown in green. The starlight method, which here shown in blue and in magenta, depending if you use the Miles library and the Stellib library. And finally, the PPXF method, which as we apply using the Miles library, shown in red. On the left, you see the observed original spectrum. And here, for example, I select the spectrum A, which is the one showing the most absorbed H-alpha emission, and then a spectrum F and N, which showing a higher H-alpha emission. And here you are already able to see that we have different shapes in the line profiles. This different shape can be transformed into different values, different range of value for each spectrum. For what concerns the wavelength, which is shown in the x-axis, and the velocity dispersion in the y-axis. Each result has been identified using different symbol when different line fitting cases, according to the specific, depending on the specific line fitting case applied, and the different methods are identified using different colors. So these are the results obtained for the H-alpha line. We are able to obtain for each spectrum a mean value of the wavelength of the velocity dispersion, and a combination of total values can be obtained for each spectrum. And although the true kinematic parameters of each individual spectrum are unknown, we are able to quantify the uncertainty associated to such a choice, computing the standard deviation. And the standard deviation in these cases is shown using light red area, which are these big crosses in each panel. As you see, we drive a decreasing trend, both for the wavelength and both for the velocity dispersion when moving from the spectrum A to the spectrum L. And this basically reflects the fact that we are increasing the H alpha signal to noise when moving from the spectrum A to the spectrum L. We did the same with the nitrogen 2 lines. These are all the combination of tape fringe spectrum and the standard deviation for the wavelength velocity dispersion. And here we get an opposite trend, since, as I said before, the nitrogen has an opposite trend with respect to the H alpha emission. And in this case, we attain more stable and constant values for both wavelength and width for the different spectra. In this plot, I represent in a schematic view the dispersion I obtain when considering H alpha result, here shown in red, and nitrogen 2 result shown in blue. On the left are the dispersion obtained for the wavelength parameter, and on the right, those obtained for the velocity dispersion. We can obtain a maximum value of 0.2 obtained for the velocity dispersion, 0.2 Armstrong. And these basically are the systemic errors associated to the choice of a specific stellar subtraction method. This trend, as I mentioned before, reflects the line intensity ratio, which basically we have a decreasing value for the H alpha emission. And we get more stable and constant values for the nitrogen 2 line, since this line is less affected by stellar absorption. Here I show the mean kinematic result averaged over all individual spectra. So on the top panel, we see the result obtained for the H alpha line. In the bottom panel, the nitrogen 2 line results. If you focus on the panel of the right, we can see that if we average over a different method, we get the following trend. And you see these are the unsubtracted data, Firitis-Dries and Starlight using MILES, Starlight Study Library, and PPXF using MILE libraries. In case you average over the different length fitting casing, these are the other trends you get. All these combinations can be summarized in the figure on the left, in which we see basically that when moving from the unsubtracted data, which are those represented in orange, to the PPXF, moving from orange, blue, green, magenta, and red, we found a decreasing trend for the wavelength deviation, while an increasing trend for the sigma width deviation. And as you see here, the range in wavelength is quite small with respect to that shown for the velocity dispersion. A similar trend has been obtained for the nitrogen 2 line, but they show a smaller range of value. Particularly, the PPXF method is the one that shows the higher deviation with respect to the other methods. If we now compare the results we obtain when the same method has been used, as in the case of the blue and the magenta square, and using different stellar library, and we compare those results with those derived when different stellar, different methods are used using the same stellar library, as in the case of the blue and red square, we see that we obtain larger deviation when different methods are considered, of a factor of 2, approximately. We now want to gauge if our uncertainty are compatible with the error return by the line fitting routine derived from the output covariance matrix. In the top right of this slide, I show you the parameter we are using that we plot here in the X and the Y axis. This basically, for the wavelength and for the velocity dispersion, gives us the ratio, the number of sigma, by which its result departs from the mean value. And here, for example, you can see that we can reach up to 2 sigma deviation for the wavelength and for the velocity dispersion. We now include an extra correction term accounting for the contribution coming from the choice of a specific stellar subtraction method. This is the value I showed you before of 0.2 Armstrong, which I show you the graphics of the H alpha nitrogen 2 lines. If we add this component to our normalization factor, we end up with a smaller deviation both for the wavelength and the velocity dispersion. And in particular, we get 1 sigma error bars. According to this plot, we can say that all methods are considered statistically consistent among them. And you see that 1 sigma is an upper limit, since in the other, in most of the cases, when the H alpha emission in signal to noise ratio increases, we get very, very small deviation. We propose a simple prescription in order to relate the uncertainty associated to the choice of a stellar subtraction method and the instrumental profile of our data. In our case, we are using MUSE, whose instrumental profile is of the order of 1.1 Armstrong. And so, according to this equation, we can derive a conversion factor of 0.2. This conversion factor obviously has to be checked using other kind of galaxy, for example, more complex galaxy, and using different instruments. So here the summary of my talk. We can conclude that the most important ingredient affecting the variation of the gas kinematics is comes from the choice of the stellar subtracting method, then followed by the choice of the stellar library and line fitting approach. We obtain typical systemic error associated to the choice of a specific stellar subtraction method of the order of 0.2. We obtain most stable results when the nitrogen 2 line is considered, since this galaxy is less affected than H alpha by stellar absorption. So we conclude that although the subtraction of the stellar continuum is critical in order to recover line fluxes, any method, including none, can be used to measure the gas kinematics, as long as an additional component is added to the error budget. So we need to investigate further to check the validity of our prescription, and it will be possible with the advent of the next generation instrument as Origins and JWST. So thank you very much for your attention, and time for questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor, for your wonderful presentation. Yes, yes, Professor, you can.
Thank you very much for your talk. My question is the following. For in reality, H-alpha, stellar H-alpha, can have very complicated profile. For example, two emissions separated by absorption. In this case, how you can fit profile?
And you mean when the H alpha is
H alpha can have two emissions separated by absorption. P signi, for example, profile or something like this. You mean not simply Gaussian profile?
Ah, yes. Yes. Well, in this case, it's basically the velocity dispersion is the parameter which is most affected by the choice of the specific stellar subtraction method. And generally study, actually I've never seen a P signi profile for the H alpha emission actually. And I work with a quite complex galaxy in with the H alpha profile, very, very complex, but we have to check this with a specific particular example in order to check if our results are robust enough to obtain similar conclusion to what we have obtained.
Okay, thank you.